If not, Stephanie will let me know. So per New Hampshire RSA 91A23B, the chair has declared the COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at a meeting pursuant to the governor's executive order 2004 section 8 as extended by executive order 2021-01 and emergency order 12 section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their location and any person present with them at that location, and all votes will be by roll call. So I'll start. Kathy Lynch, I'm in Sarasota, Florida, and my husband is someplace in our rental home.
And Burner, 77 State Street. My husband is elsewhere in the building.
Bianca?
Bianca Montero, I'm in my office in the hospital, 16 Hospital Drive.
James?
James Peterson, I'm in my office at 127 Parrot Ave.
Rich?
I'm currently at my home on 16 Dunham Way in Portsmouth. I'm in a room by myself. My wife is somewhere else in the house.
So it's my understanding that Kristen and Tony don't need to do this. Is that correct, Stephanie?
Because Kim is not able to make this meeting, one of them should be, one or both should be the designated committee representatives and should identify themselves.
Kristen so raised her hand. Kristen?
Yeah, it's me. I'm Kristen Shaw, currently at my home in Epping, New Hampshire. My husband is here as well, working in his home office.
And Tony, you get a pass. So we have a quorum to conduct business. So the first item on the agenda is approving the minutes of last week. So is there a motion? Rich made the motion. Second?
I'll second.
James seconded. Okay. Were there any corrections, additions, or deletions to the draft that had already not been identified? Seeing none, we'll roll call. For all in favor, aye. Anne?
Aye.
Everyone said aye. I heard them. Stephanie might not have heard them, but I heard them. So the next thing on the agenda is the dashboard. So let me share my screen. And there we have the dashboard. So Stephanie, do you want to follow up on your comments about the positivity rates?
Yes, the significant difference in this week's dashboard for your discussion is the New Hampshire positivity. It continues, the data from three different sources are conflicting in a manner that I am unable to explain. The explanation that I found last week, that the difference when the state is saying 6 or 8%, state DHHS is saying 6 or 8%, and Johns Hopkins is reporting 12 or 13%. The reason for that was given is that it depends on how the average is statistically determined. If you take data before you aggregate to average or after you aggregate to average, to simplify. That wouldn't seem to produce a 100% difference between 6 and 12. So I am concerned that we cannot explain the difference and that we are using DHHS as our reliable source of information. The data that the other aggregators use comes from DHHS. So it's a challenge to explain why the blue chart in the lower left is saying that the current positivity in New Hampshire is 6.1%, whereas Johns Hopkins is saying higher. So that's kind of part A. Part B is that it might be that the most important positivity number for the audience for this dashboard is the Rockingham County positivity. That number comes from DHHS. That number continues to be higher, as we know, than the statewide one. So the question is, do we continue to post a New Hampshire positivity or not?
Comments?
I would just remind you that we have set a precedent where we took a few weeks off from showing certain data points because we couldn't explain them. And we were open about that when we were part of the CRTF, when we went through the dashboard. Remember the Johns Hopkins graphs? There were some big chunks missing for New Hampshire and little things like that. So if we think it's important to follow New Hampshire positivity, I don't know which data source is being used, for example, for the governor to make decisions, but just because we decide to take it off now doesn't mean we can never go back to it.
Bianca, do you have any opinion one way or the other?
I think since this is an official document that we have to follow and put it in the website, I guess we have to follow the local CDC. I don't know why it's different. There's definitely something in the calculation, but I think we would have to utilize, in my opinion, the local information, because we cannot offer one that it's from outside and then New Hampshire CDC says something different.
Are you comfortable with that, Stephanie? Uh-oh, it looks like we lost her. I'm sure she'll come back on. Okay, so just sort of quickly looking at the dashboard, you can see that New Hampshire's done pretty good job in terms of our vaccinations. And as we mentioned a couple of meetings ago, we see things that are, here's Stephanie's coming back on. We see that, infections are clearly starting to plateau, which is a good sign. And hopefully that will get even better as more people are vaccinated. Numbers stay down in both Massachusetts and Maine. And in New Hampshire, we're hopefully on a continued downward trend. Stephanie, did you? Yeah, I know you went off, so.
Yeah, I apologize at the most critical moment. Anne, would you repeat yourself, please?
Oh, I was just mentioning that we had set a precedent for holding data when it didn't make sense to us. Remember with the JHU data, there were some gaps there. So if we take New Hampshire positivity off, that doesn't mean we can never go back to it. And then I also said that it would be good to include New Hampshire positivity because it might form the basis for some statewide decisions. And then Bianca had comments too. I don't know if you were on for those or not.
No,
she missed Bianca.
Yeah, it was to utilize the New Hampshire CDC data since this is a official document that it goes into the city of Portsmouth instead of using the Johns Hopkins data. Although I don't know which one will be more reliable in terms of the reality because of calculation, but I guess we have to use the New Hampshire CDC.
Anne?
New Hampshire CDC, New Hampshire DHHS.
DHHS, correction.
Rich?
Yeah, so I was wondering if we used whatever data we use for the New Hampshire, maybe we'd be open about it and have an asterisk and give a footnote saying that there is some discrepancy between different reporting, just so that people are aware that if they see the differences, that we also acknowledge that there is a difference.
Is that Stephanie?
I'm happy to do whatever the committee decides.
I'd like to keep this as simple as possible so that if people go online to look at it, they can look at it relatively easily. So why don't, for right now, we just keep with the New Hampshire data and we'll see what happens with that. And is it possible to keep kind of a separate eye on the Johns Hopkins data and see whether or not these differences trend in a consistent fashion? Because I have a feeling it's just in the mathematics.
So we always use the Johns Hopkins graph in the lower right, and the three state graphs in the middle are driven by, they're from COVID Act now, but they're driven by Johns Hopkins information. So they, I haven't directly compared the two graphs, but they should be closer. One thing on now using DHHS information, returning the line about New Hampshire positivity, we will, because we have this week and last week, that line on this chart would now say New Hampshire positivity 6.8% this week, 13.9% last week.
I like those changes.
That means significant decrease.
Right.
Although we should be comparing apples to apples, yeah, whatever the numbers are.
Let me ask you this, Stephanie. Since the blue graph on the lower right has the 7-day positivity at 6.1%, we have that written there. And since right across it is the Johns Hopkins data where the numbers are a little bit different, if someone wants us to explain the difference, we can say that we're not quite sure why it is. We think it's the way that they handle the numbers, and just leave the top at Rockingham County. Stephanie's stuck.
Yeah, she's frozen. But yeah. So the only problem to that is we can discuss that in the committee and then verbally explain. But any person that goes, for example, to the City of Portsmouth website looking for that information,
right,
not quite understand why there is this huge difference between the graph, the blue graph on the left and the Johns Hopkins on the right, right? That's the only.
So Bianca, maybe that's where we can put in the asterisk that Rich suggested, saying we recognize that these two numbers are different and it is our assumption it's because of the way they handle the data, because they're getting the data from the same source.
Yeah, if we can do that, because there's already so much information underneath.
Right.
It's just going to get so busy, right? It is a good point, but it's going to be super busy to add that in there somewhere.
What do other people think?
Kristen has a hand up.
Kristen?
Well, I was just wondering, I kind of like the idea of potentially not using it if we don't need to for the Johns Hopkins, lower down on the right next to the blue one, because that is confusing and there is a lot of verbiage on that page right there. We know that the state's numbers change daily. What they put out is not fully accurate. I think Kim sent an email around mentioning that earlier today. If we're going to work off of DHHS, maybe this graph doesn't need to be here currently.
So your suggestion is get rid of this graph right here.
Possibly, if it's going to remain different. And as Bianca pointed out, how are we going to explain it? We really don't have any space left on this graph in total.
What do people think about eliminating that graph? Anne?
When Kristen started to speak, I was just looking at this and trying to figure out what we could take off. I was actually looking for verbiage to take off, but now that Kristen mentioned it, I really like that idea. As these graphs go out in time, it's getting harder and harder to read because each little peak is so tiny and the dates and everything's getting smaller. We do have that information elsewhere. I think that would really make the whole flow nicer, make a little bit more space to make things maybe a little bit larger and add the footnote that Rich recommended.
Mm-hmm. Stephanie, is that doable? Okay, how many, just show of hands, are people comfortable with removing that graph? Yes, okay. So why don't we remove that graph? It might even allow that kind of blue graph on the left-hand side to be made a little bit bigger, a little bit easier to read possibly. Yeah. And then we'll just keep the positivities up here as they're reported by New Hampshire DHHS. But overall, I mean, overall, when I saw this after Stephanie sent it, and as I've read in the paper every day, you know, I'm beginning to feel like hopefully we're reaching a plateau and that we'll be able to start seeing some improvement that hopefully will continue as we have more vaccinations and people continue to follow the, you know, safer at home guidelines. Okay, let me stop sharing this.
Kathy.
Yes?
A question about that plateau.
Uh-huh.
So we've been in that 5,000 to 6,000 range for a lot of weeks. Does anybody recall where we were on previous spikes or high points? Because the 5,000 to 6,000 seems like a lot of cases to me, and I'm not showing in our data how that compares with, say, May for number of cases.
Stephanie has an answer.
The graph in top third of the page, right under the vaccine or the next bar under the vaccination map. Kathy, if you could toss that up again.
Hold on, I have to reshare.
Sorry.
That's okay.
And I hope I don't lose you all by talking. the bar chart that I've added on the left, COVID infections, the blue line, yes. So
right here.
Yep, the blue line is daily, or the infections for that day as of the day that I did the dashboard. So you can see going back to July, we were at under 1,000 a day, 500 a day, now we're at 5,000 new cases.
So I think, James, what the plateau is, I mean, if you go from here on up, this is Halloween followed by Thanksgiving, followed by Christmas and New Year's. And so I think those were the results that we saw from people who were gathering in any kind of a situation, along with increased community transmission through here. So the plateauing is really, at this point in time, kind of post-holiday plateau that, you know, I'm just hoping that we'll continue to see this blue line here kind of trend downward.
Yeah, my question had to do with the amplitude of the plateau, 5,000 to 6,000, and how that compares to previous high points. I think May may have been a high point. You know, was it 1,000 in May, 1,000 to 2,000, and now we're 5,000 to 6,000? You know, that's my question.
Yeah, I hear that question. Stephanie,
I'm just looking for a relative, yeah. relative information of how, even though we're plateauing right now, how, you know, how bad's the plateau?
Stephanie, back over here, if we go down one where we're looking at these tricolor maps here for New Hampshire, right. What is the very beginning of this one? Is that starting right at last March?
Because I think so.
Yeah, I can't read the...
But that is positivity rate. That is not the total number of cases. So
right, okay. That goes to April, but... that's also the Johns Hopkins data that is positivity, the one, okay. The chart we're taking out towards the bottom. But yeah, I can look up what the actual daily, it was not anywhere near 1,000 in the spring.
I didn't think so either. Yeah, Bianca?
So in terms of amplitude, we are in a much higher number level, total number of cases. We are way higher, maybe like four or five times where we were in April and May. But remember, if we look at graphs and positivity graphs, the positivity back in April and May was very high because we were not doing enough tests, right? So almost every test we did was positive. So that brings positivity way up. Now we are doing tons of testing, but now we have also a lot more cases. So we are plateauing. Plateau is a good sign, but nowhere near where we were back in the spring and summer. We're still having a lot of infections every day. So it's a good sign, plateauing. Hopefully we'll start coming down, but number total number of cases, it's way much higher than before.
Rich?
Yeah, that's, of course, when you have a plateau that's so much higher, the problem is, particularly in the winter like we have now, the plateau is so high, that means you have so much more community transmission potential because there are so many people with infection out there. And these are just the ones that we know about. So when you have this level of a plateau, 800 to 1,000 cases a day, that's a bad sign for ongoing community transmission, if particularly if people are not following the proper public health recommendations.
But I'd rather a plateau than a spike. Let's look at the good side. So anyway, Stephanie, I think probably it would be easy for us to go back and get those numbers if we just look at other dashboards that we had early in the year. So
yeah, actually, we didn't start doing a dashboard until July, but certainly DHHS will have daily infection rate reports back to March.
Okay. So I put vaccination update on the agenda because
Kristen has her hand raised.
Oh, I'm sorry, Kristen. I didn't see that.
That's okay. I just have a question for James. James, are you thinking that we need to still display infectivity rate as a graph rather than just a reporting of the percentage?
I was thinking that we maybe needed to provide context. You know, the good news is that we have not stayed on that trajectory. But the bad news is that we're plateauing very high.
Yeah. Yeah, when I suggested we're moving that graph, I don't mean forever, maybe just until we can iron out how the differences and make it easier to explain to the general public the difference between the two.
And my other comment about it is that, you know, it doesn't seem to me that relative news is good news in a pandemic. You know, we're doing less terrible or more terrible. I think absolute information seems more what we want to pay attention to. You know, total number of cases, things of that nature, not total number of cases compared to where we were. I think trending is really important to know whether we're getting worse or better. But I think I'm surprised, for example, and I'm curious why people seem to have become so relatively complacent when it seems to me we're plateauing at a place that's just dramatically different than anything we've ever seen in the history of the pandemic.
Stephanie?
Yeah, to the point about making that blue graphic bigger, in the middle of that blue graphic is a chart showing daily cases starting in March, which is, has a significant impact. So making that bigger on our dashboard will help address some of that information.
Okay, and then just one thing before we move on to James' comment. I think, James, what we're seeing is pandemic fatigue, and we're seeing some amount of maybe incautious behavior around the fact that vaccinations are becoming available. So there may be some lack of appreciation of the fact that a vaccination doesn't equal immediate immunity. And those are just issues that we're going to have to try to continue to address. See how things go. But I did just want to
telling people that when they get vaccinated, what that really means in terms of their protection level between the first and second dose, and even after the second dose, how long before they are considered protected, at least up to about 95%. So that's information that must be given out during the vaccination process.
And that messaging is being done. We're doing that messaging. That messaging is in the media. That messaging is, you know, again, this is one of those issues where we can do all the messaging we want. The issue is whether or not people act on the message. So. Yeah.
But I think it's really critical at the point of vaccination. At that point, I think that's probably the most attentive period you're going to have for individuals when on a one-to-one to tell them exactly what it means when they get their first shot and what it means when they get in between their first and second shot. I think that's a real teachable moment.
And my understanding is that that's exactly what's happening, that you are given a information sheet when you have your first dose, and that explains what to do to get your second dose, but it also explains what you should expect.
Yeah.
Anne?
I assume there's also verbal emphasis, because that's kind of a pillar of healthcare education. So people need to hear it and have something to take home and digest.
Yeah, I agree.
Kristen, I know that as part of the Seacoast response, the health department has been involved in that. Have you seen that document?
It's many pages, actually. We just held our first clinic, or we assisted at a clinic last week. And I have personally gone through for my first vaccination as well at the Fix site here in Exeter. And it's got to be 6 pages of material that are provided to people at the time of their vaccination. The vaccinators were informing their patients of follow-up at the clinic that I was at. I believe I was just told that a VAM system would let me know when I could register for my second shot personally, but
is it possible for you to just share that document with all of us?
Sure. I'll scan it in. So I'll put it out later this afternoon.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, guys, we need to move on. So I'm sure everyone has read in the paper that the vaccination rollout, while it had some glitches, went pretty well. And hopefully we'll continue to see that progress. I think the big issue really in New Hampshire and in any state is the number of doses that are available. And so we'll really need to keep an eye on dose availability and then the logistics of delivery. Because once they get to the delivery sites, I think we're doing a good job. So let's move on to the FAQs. And you wanna start with the daily life and masking FAQs?
I sent both of them out. When did I send? Sunday night, I think. So I'm sorry you didn't have a little more time, but I was hoping that people would have had a chance to at least look through them. And so unless you want me to run through all of the changes, I would just open it up for any comments. I'd like to thank Stephanie for hers. And I think she's the only one I've heard from. So, and she copied all of you. So I think we're ready to go unless people want more time or want anything explained or have any further recommendations.
No, it's so helpful when the changes are highlighted, you know, to be able to look at them quickly. I thought everything was great. Anybody?
I'm still in training, but I think Stephanie is bringing me around.
Anybody have any questions on those? So we're good to go. Okay. And then I did send out that the article about the LabCorp mail-in test for everyone to read. Because I was thinking about adding that to the testing FAQ. Did anyone have any questions or issues? Is anyone uncomfortable with that? Nope. Are you okay if I add it? Yep, okay, I'll add that in. And then, because I really have nothing else to do, I started the COVID What Now FAQ. So I guess we'll open that up for a little bit of discussion. One of the interesting things is that this week there have been a number of articles in the public press, as well as in the professional literature, as well as on professional CDC and other sites about COVID long haulers. Luckily, the information is all very consistent. Stephanie, thank you for alerting me and everyone in the group to that webinar that will be held this week on long haulers. So I didn't get any feedback at all, other than from Anne, who I think said, great start. So I'm wondering, are we ready to go ahead and post that? Do you want more time to look at it? Do you want to wait till after the webinar?
I think we could post it and then see if anything changes with the webinar, and make, if we have to make changes, we could adjust it as necessary.
Okay.
I think it's become pretty phenomenal how quickly and how responsive the group has been and how quickly we're getting things updated. So I wouldn't hesitate to go ahead. If we need to add anything after the webinar, can.
Okay, Kristen?
Kathy, I'm glad that you're gonna be able to attend that. We have another training meeting that we cannot miss at the same time as the CDC briefing is going to be. So appreciate that you're going to listen in and let us know of any changes. I'm hoping it's going to be recorded so we can listen to it later, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, I hope so too. So yeah. Bianca, are you okay if we go ahead and post? Okay. So yeah. Stephanie, I think I did pretty good always calling it COVID-19 in the document, because like I was trying to remember and I'm trying to do really good with its and its. So hopefully we'll be all set. Good. Okay. The next thing, Rich?
I just want to make a funny comment. I thought it was pretty interesting that the rest of the world has caught up to our discussion on the issue of morbidity, not just mortality. So that's good.
I was
Wall
thinking
Street
that
Journal today too.
I was thinking that too. I was thinking they must have known we're doing an FAQ. So health.
I don't have anything new to bring to the table this week, other than that our first round working in a vaccination clinic was very successful. And it went over really, really well. We have several, Seacoast Public Health Network is conducting 3 or 4 other closed clinics this week, as well as Ports and Fire Department is also participating in 3. So, you know, we're moving things right along as well as we can, and really no glitches to speak of. And I can say in the clinic that I worked, we had no adverse reactions at all in all of the people we put through. That was good.
So, Kristen, what do you mean by a closed clinic?
So there are closed vaccination clinics happening for places outside of long-term care, but for special needs populations, other groups who may not be able to get to a fixed site, like the 13 sites around. You may hear the state refer to them as their mobile clinics, but they're restricted to who's receiving. It's people that fall under phase 1B, okay, but that may not be able to get themselves to a fixed site.
Okay.
Yeah.
Someone had their hand up. Anne?
I was curious. I'd like everybody's opinion, but maybe especially Kristen's. I thought that there was a very robust response when the phase 1B opened up and the website opened up. And so to me, that was encouraging because we're worried about vaccine acceptance. And I've heard that there were almost 200,000 requests. Mm-hmm. But what's the denominator for that? What does that say about acceptance rate? I know how, like, I can check how many people are over 65, but then there are all these other groups that are suddenly eligible. Does anybody have a sense of what proportion of people who became eligible actually went in and asked about getting a vaccine?
I heard that there's the overall target population is about 325,000, 200,000 signed up, and 60% of those have a date for vaccination. 60% of the 200,000.
And then of the 350,000, you wonder how many of them might have already been vaccinated in the 1A category.
I understood that the population for the 1B was about 325,000 people in the 1B category.
So, but my comment is, let's say, for example, you're a 70-year-old physician seeing patients, you'd fit into 1B because you're over 65, but you would have been vaccinated in 1A because you're seeing patients.
Right. They may not be included in that 1B category at that point. I think that I'm not sure if they took them all out. It's, you know, there might be some duplication in that.
Yeah, I would think it would be almost impossible to take them out. Anyway. I guess we're just going to have to wait and see kind of, you know, how many people end up getting vaccinated. I have read that while there were many people pre-vaccine availability who were like, I'm not getting vaccinated, once the vaccines became available, they had a little change of heart. Okay, so Anne, we have a little bit of time about your email to me about maybe article reviews.
It's funny because I brought this up a couple of weeks ago. We didn't have time last week, but we've actually, before the topic came to the committee, we've already started talking about it. And that is whether or not we should be distributing information from non-academic sites. This came up when Rich told us about the piece that he had seen on Patch last week, and it's come up now and again, but I'll give you the two examples I was thinking of. One was an article that I saw in the New York Times. So it was, I think it was written probably by a health journalist who was, and it was an interview with the authors of a paper. James, I'm sure you saw this. If you're sitting in a car with someone else, doesn't have to be a comedian, but if you're in a car with someone else, which windows should you open and how can you have the best airflow to protect yourselves from one another? You know, wearing your mask and the study documented that it would be best to have like kitty corner rather than the one right next to each person and where you should sit in the back on the other side, that sort of thing. So I was thinking that would be a good thing to just put out there if we all agreed. You know, Stephanie could maybe reference it in one of her emails or blasts, but traditionally we haven't done that sort of thing. Just wondering if it's something we ought to consider to get information that we think is important out there quickly. And then the second example, I think I also saw this in the New York Times, was the first time I heard about double masking, and that was a while ago now, but I've seen more and more about it. So that's another example of something by a respected health journalist, you know, not necessarily from an academic, but a way that it's already been rewritten so that the lay public would understand it, that we could quickly put out there. That's what I've been thinking about.
Bianca?
So I think every time we want to publish something about a health journalist or someone that does an editorial or a commentary, we always have to furnish with credible data, meaning studies, because he might utilize his own opinion, he might utilize his own experience, and that becomes anecdotal and then doesn't necessarily mean that that's true and is statistically significant. So I would sort of always, if we're going to put something like this, to always put it together with the studies that are supporting that information.
Stephanie?
Yeah, the other issue, and I don't know the answer to it, and I will find out for this group, is some New York Times stories are behind a paywall. And if they are, I think we run into copyright issues if we turn them into PDFs like I do to share them with this group. So that may be a limiting factor.
So what if a way to address this and meet a proper kind of peer review scientific authenticity is if we find something that we feel would be important to share with the public, provided it's scientifically supported, that person who reads it then does just a literature search to see if they can find the studies that supported the article that was published. Similar to the way that I went back and looked at the studies around the ventilation thing. And both Bianca and Stephanie were very helpful in identifying those studies. And then interestingly enough, either Kristen or Tony you know, sent the same reference, meaning that, you know, a lot of articles are referring to the exact same study that was done. In that way, we can look at it from a scientific point of view and then decide how to summarize it and provide a link. Does that sound reasonable? I mean, this is not like everyone's going to have homework because everyone's very busy, but you know, if we do come across an article that we think has important information to share, even for our own selves, we need to go back and look at primary sources. Stephanie?
One other aspect to that is it would be helpful for me if you as committee members would determine where the best place is to post that information. What we've been doing so far that works really well is to add research and articles to the existing facts or to identify a new topic that we need more frequently asked questions. So if you could do both of those things.
Okay. So I guess my recommendation would be if you come across something that you share with the group that we think has important information, one person in the group just take the lead to review the back, you know, the references for that particular article. And then we'll come back to the group to decide whether or not we should post that. Does that sound fair?
Yeah.
Okay. At one point I was afraid we were gonna run out of time. Now we have extra time, Anne.
I was just going to ask if that one about where you should sit in the car and what windows should be open, maybe that could be added to the ventilation FAQ.
Was there a study that demonstrated that?
There was an airflow study. James? Okay. James will be able to address that.
Well, no, I can't address that. I haven't read that article, but related to that, you know, studies are a source of information, but not the only source of information in terms of ventilation. So, you know, ASHRAE, I would suggest, is a reliable peer-reviewed source. And then there's the hygienist group. And so I think we have to have more sources that qualify besides studies with respect to ventilation.
But James, when ASHRAE publishes something, isn't it based upon studies that have been done?
No, not necessarily. It's ASHRAE publishes standards based on a peer review consensus method. And then with respect to ventilation, for example, in my 30-year career, those ASHRAE recommendations around ventilation eventually become code requirements for buildings.
But there's a peer review.
So it's disappointing. There's a peer review component, but it is disappointing that ventilation does not have a strong basis in studies and you know the way we like it to be. I think this may change how ventilation laws come to be. But the fact of the matter is that there's not much basis in solid science around ventilation codes and requirements.
And could you
say that? It's experts. It's experts in the field, essentially.
And could you send that study to us so that we can look at it? Mm-hmm. That would be helpful then. Rich?
I just want to say that the EPA indoor air section does do some work and have some data regarding ventilation and that sort of thing in terms of indoor air quality standards. So.
Okay. Anybody have any other? Here, I was afraid we were going to go over and we're going to end early. So I just need a motion then to adjourn. Bianca and Anne seconded. I'm in favor. James in favor. Rich in favor. Bianca in favor. Kristen in favor. Tony and Stephanie don't have to vote, but I'm sure they're in favor. Okay, so I will see you all next week.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Or tomorrow, maybe.
Oh, that's right.
Tomorrow.